Welcome to this week's Sight for White Talking News for Friday, the 23rd of April, 2021.
This is Brian reading an article from the Island Echo. What are the odds? Betting shop signage falls down in busy town centre. 40 feet of signage on the front of Betfred in Newport has come crashing down, narrowly avoiding causing serious injury to passers-by. Rather bizarrely, the signage fell off without warning at around 11:30 on Thursday morning, creating a large bang. One piece of the bright blue panelling has been left hanging, with three other large panels laid across the pavement on St James's Street. The area has been cordoned off for safety. Betfred occupies the former Dixon's store on St James's Street, close to McDonald's and next door to CEX. A Betfred spokesman has said, "We've immediately launched an investigation."
This is Chris, reading an article from the Island Echo. Sewage flows onto the beach at Apley, following pump failure. Exclusion zones have been set up around raw sewage that has flooded parts of Ryde Esplanade and flowed onto the beach following a pump failure overnight. Local walkers arrived at Apley on Sunday morning to a strong smell of sewage, with a fast flow of effluent cascading down steps and onto the sandy beach. Southern Water says that the temporary pumping system that bypasses the collapsed sewer at Apley failed overnight, meaning it has not been properly shifting all of Ryde's wastewater to the main pumping station. To ensure the safety of the public, exclusion zones are in place in the immediate areas. This is in addition to the existing works which have been causing disruption in the area since January. A completion date for the repair project has not yet been given, but it is thought that work could continue until at least October. A digger is being used to scoop up contaminated sand. Engineers are said to be working quickly on the emergency repair, and Southern Water is liaising with the Isle of Wight Council and the Environment Agency to minimise impact. Reassurances have been given that the water company will clean up the areas after the issue with the pumps has been resolved. In a statement, a spokesman for Southern Water has said, "We are very sorry that the temporary pumping system bypassing the collapsed sewer at Apley Beach failed overnight. This has resulted in some effluent escaping out of manhole covers on the promenade. To ensure the safety of the public, we will set up an exclusion zone around the immediate areas. We are working quickly on the emergency repair and liaising with the Isle of Wight Council and the Environment Agency to minimise impact. We will clean up the area after the issue with the pumps is resolved."
This is Michael reading an article from the Isle of Wight County Press. Isle of Wight Whitelink Fastcat returns, date revealed. Whitelink's fast cats will return on April the 29th. The foot passenger sailings between Portsmouth Harbour and Ryde Pierhead will be hourly and on school holiday weekends and during the Isle of Wight Festival. Two catamarans will operate.
This is Petrina reading from Island Echo. Unions join forces after plans to axe 15 jobs at Sandown School revealed. One staff member said they were appalled by the treatment of the staff over the past few years as the future of 15 jobs is under threat in latest consultation. Trade unions have joined forces to challenge cost-cutting plans at the Bay CE School on the Isle of Wight, which could see up to 15 jobs axed. GMB Unison, NASUWT and NAU unions are concerned following the resumption of budget-slashing consultation meetings. The Bay, which took over the former Academies Enterprise Trust, Sandown Bay Academy, has developed proposals which raise more questions than give answers, the GMB says. The proposed changes could see up to 15 jobs axed, with remaining staff suffering detrimental changes to their working hours and other terms and conditions. Adrian Baker, GMB Union Regional Organiser, said, "Staff feel that above all else, the pupils and the wider community will suffer as a result of these changes due to a heavily increased workload, leaving less time available to both fulfil their roles to the best of their ability and support the most important part of any school, the pupils." Meanwhile, the Academy's financial statements are a mess, GMB says. Staffing costs are down as more than 100% of budget, whereas they were previously 74%, with staff numbers down since then. Other figures are out of date and in some instances don't match detail by the employer on government websites. Unions are requesting that the process be scrapped and a fresh review of all financial detail and all potential impacts made. A joint letter to be submitted to governors says unions are unanimous in calling for a new, fully comprehensive consultation document to be created, as it is strongly felt last year's paper is not appropriate, with many changes to staffing levels during the past 12 months. Adrian Baker, GMB Union Regional Organiser, said, "The strength of feeling of the staff on this matter is quite extraordinary. They feel that above all else, the pupils and the wider community will suffer as a result of these changes due to a heavily increased workload, leaving less time available to both fulfil their roles to the best of their ability and support the most important part of any school, the pupils. All unions have concerns relating to the figures given, the impact of the cuts on safeguarding, health and safety and morale at the school, as well as the impact on young people within the community. There has been a stop-start mechanism to this process due to the pandemic, and all unions involved believe that a fresh approach needs to be taken with a review in the proposals, an impact assessment on all the roles going forward, and that an updated set of figures be presented by the employer." A Bay School employee, who asked to remain anonymous, said the consultation is being based on other secondary school models and not on our school or how it will operate under the staffing mechanisms of others. "We are dealing with an old school spread over three buildings, students from poor, vulnerable homes, higher rates of mental health problems after COVID, more behaviour problems after COVID, future building works, rooms not fitted for purpose, large class sizes, teachers teaching many subjects, and they should be taking all of these into consideration. I'm appalled by the treatment of the staff over the past few years. We have had the news of the consultation previously, which was stressful and upsetting, with it then being put on hold as we were thrown into COVID. It saddens me that the very people who are potentially being made redundant or losing pay are the very people who keep the school going throughout all the lockdowns. The very staff who have been in for all of the children at their own risk, and many caught COVID themselves. the very people who tested thousands of students and staff with less protection than the NHS, only now to be treated like this, shown the door or forced to do the same job or joint roles for less money. I am genuinely worried about the safety, the level of education and the happiness of our students if this goes ahead. If they took away one member of the leadership team, it would pay for four of us who are all on the floor helping run the school. I am so fed up with them putting money above safety, well-being, education, support and community.
Hello, this is Steve reading a story from the Island Echo, headlined 30-year-old being quizzed following armed police standoff in Sandown. Police are questioning a 30-year-old man over allegations of a fray and criminal damage following Wednesday's large-scale incident in Sandown, which saw a number of armed police respond to a standoff situation. As first reported by the Island Echo, emergency services descended on Avenue Road in the town at around 3:15 in the afternoon, after concerns for an individual's welfare were raised with police. Upon the arrival of officers, threats were made that if they were to enter the address, he would set it on fire. The male also refused to leave the property. Despite local rumours, it has been confirmed no one else was inside the property. The situation quickly developed, and four authorised firearms officers, that's AFOs, from the island were deployed to the scene. Soon after, at least four additional armed officers from the mainland were whizzed across the Solent to Ryde Pier before joining their colleagues at the Sandown standoff. Several crews from Hampshire and Isle of Wight Fire and Rescue Service were also mobilised to the scene, with firefighters donning breathing apparatus and standing by just in case they needed to rush into the building. It's understood that threats had the Isle of Wight Ambulance Service were also present at the scene as part of the multi-agency response to the situation. Nearby properties were evacuated and a cordon was erected around the immediate area between Carter Street, Fort Street and Crescent Road. Inside the cordon, a police car sustained a smashed windscreen when what is believed to be a TV was thrown out of a window. The incident concluded by 5 p.m. and the road reopened shortly after. Hampshire Constabulary has confirmed that a 30-year-old man has been arrested on suspicion of a fray and criminal damage. He remains in custody for questioning by officers investigating the incident. Threats had been made to set the property on fire, with an actual fire also reported inside the address.
Hugh Edwards welcomes cash for Isle of Wight's Minster Church, the Isle of Wight County Press. An Isle of Wight church is to receive £30,000 from the National Churches Trust. The cornerstone grant is to help fund urgent repairs to the Minster Church of St Thomas in Newport. The church will also be given an extra £10,000, a Wolfson fabric repair grant, from the Wolfson Foundation on the recommendation of the National Churches Trust. Sitting on Historic England's at-risk register, the cash will be spent on roof and stone repairs, the installation of four toilets, a new kitchen and flooring. The south aisle and south nave roof will be repaired using Douglas 4 fir timbers repairs along with new Welsh slate. Eroded stone will either undergo a mortar repair, a shelter coat to match the existing stone, or will be replaced, matching like for like, using Bath and Caen stone. Part of the ground floor is being reconfigured for use as a choir vestry, family area and for community use. The church has been on the site since the 12th century, but the current building, built on the footpath of the medieval church, dates from 1857. Much of the building material was retained from the medieval church, including cairn and core stone, and several fine 17th century furnishings, including the Flemish pulpit and a reading desk. There are several stained glass windows in the Elizabeth Chapel by the French artist Joseph Villet, dated 1858, and they were donated by Queen Victoria. In 2008, Newport Parish Church was granted the title of Minster in recognition of its contribution to the wider community. Broadcaster and journalist Hugh Edwards, Vice President of the National Churches Trust, said, "I am delighted that the Minster Church of St Thomas, Newport, is being helped with a £300,000 grant from the National Churches Trust Cornerstone Grant. The grant will safeguard unique local heritage and help St Thomas continue to support local people as we begin to emerge from the coronavirus pandemic. It's among 67 churches and chapels in England, Wales and Scotland and Northern Ireland to benefit from the latest grants, the first for 2021, from the National Churches Grant, a charity supporting church buildings of all Christian denominations across the UK.
This is Brian reading an article from the Isle of Wight County Press. Age UK launches new virtual activities for Ireland seniors. Charity Age UK Isle of Wight has launched a new range of free virtual activities for elderly people living on the island in a bid to boost well-being and offer new social opportunities. The charity hopes to support people to make connections, regain social skills and develop new networks. Each week they will deliver an exercise class or similar activity to encourage being active. The themes of the sessions will vary each week, covering aspects of heritage, wildlife, poetry and creative writing, to name but a few, so that the audience will be keeping their brains active by learning something new. The programme will build from an initial 3 sessions each week, depending on uptake. Kelly, Age UK Isle of Wight's activities coordinator, said, "We are super excited to begin to deliver this programme. We will take the time to notice the contributions of everyone, celebrate the learning journeys that our audience takes, and promote an inclusive ethos. We hope you will join us each week virtually and, when government guidance allows, at some time of our face-to-face sessions." Sessions are available via Zoom, and those interested can also watch at leisure on Age UK Isle of Wight's YouTube channel. Age UK Isle of Wight's Digital Inclusion Project offers one-to-one support for those who may need it to get online to join their virtual activities programme, even offering a technology borrowing service for those who do not currently have any access to technology but would like to get involved. For more information, call Kelly on 01983 525 282.
This is Chris reading an article from the Isle of Wight County Press. Over 5,000 emergency Isle of Wight food parcels in COVID, year one. More than 5,000 emergency food parcels were handed out by the Isle of Wight Food Bank in the first year of the COVID-19 pandemic. 2,190 of them went to children on the island. The Trussell Trust Food Bank charity is using the forthcoming May the 6th elections to challenge local candidates, asking them to commit to working to end the need for food banks. The island's 5,079 parcels, including enough supplies for 3 or 7 days, was actually a 19% decrease on the total number recorded in 2019. However, the charity says a reduction in emergency food supplies on the Isle of Wight should not be interpreted as a decrease in need. It said its data does not reveal the full scale of demand across the county because unprecedented numbers of people are being helped by other organisations. On the island, help for struggling families came from pubs, other charities, churches, shops, schools and individuals. A report by the Trussell Trust shows a record 2.5 million parcels were distributed by its food banks across the UK in 2020 to 2021, a 33% increase on the previous year. Of those, around 980,000 went to children.
This is Michael reading an article from Isle of Wight Radio. Isle of Wight police officers punch in Newport arrest being investigated. An Isle of Wight police officer's use of force when making an arrest in Newport is being investigated. Footage has been circulated online, appearing to show an officer punch a suspect as he and his colleagues arrested a man in St James's Street. In a video sent to the Isle of Wight Radio, four officers can be seen trying to restrain a man on the ground. One onlooker can be heard shouting about an officer punching the man. Hampshire Constabulary has confirmed the use of force used in the arrest is being investigated. A spokesman said, "The circumstances surrounding the arrest and use of force is being reviewed by the Constabulary's Professional Standards Department. It would be inappropriate to comment further at this time." Police say they were called to reports of an assault at the Castle Inn pub, Newport, at around 7 p.m. last night, Tuesday. Officers attended and a man was arrested on St James's Street outside McDonald's in connection with the incident. A man in his 30s arrested on suspicion of assaulting, occasionally actual bodily harm, and obstruct, resist a constable in the execution of his duty, has been released from custody with no further action. Police say the man was also dealt with by means of community resolution in relation to possession of cannabis.
This is Petrina reading an article from Isle of Wight County Press. Freshwater teen racially abused men at Newport bus station. A West Wight teen threatened three people at Newport bus station, including hurling racist abuse at two of them. 2 days later, he was offensive to an off-duty police support officer, an Isle of Wight court was told. Rhys Judge, 19, admitted causing fear by provoking violence and using racially aggravated words to two men at Newport bus station on the evening of November the 28th, 2020. Judge of Collards Close Freshwater also pleaded guilty to using threatening words and behaviour to provoke violence towards a third bus passenger, Michael Blanchard, and causing criminal damages to the bus on the same date. He also admitted using threatening words and behaviour with intent to cause alarm and distress towards an off-duty PCSO in Newport 2 days later. His accomplice on both days was a youth who cannot be named for legal reasons, handed a youth rehabilitation order for 12 months at the Isle of Wight Youth Court last week. Judge caused the bus they travelled on from Wootton to Newport to be taken out of service for cleaning after he sprayed beer all over the seats on the top deck. His actions were caught on CCTV. When Mr. Blanchard threatened to report the matter to the inspector, Judge lifted his top to reveal a kitchen knife sticking out of his trousers and threatened to shank or stab him, said Anne Smout, prosecuting at the Isle of Wight Magistrates Court on Monday. Judge and the youth then shifted their focus on two other passengers at the bus stop. They stood over them in a menacing fashion, Judge said, something to one of them which sparked an altercation, during which Judge was struck, said Mrs. Mout. The pair then insulted the man and ordered them to go back to their own country, believing them to be Polish. 2 days later in Honey Hill Stores, Newport, at around 4:30 p.m., off-duty PCSO Charlotte O'Sullivan was shopping when the pair were abusive to her. As she left the store, Judge used foul language and called her a pig, said Mrs. Smout.
Hello everyone, this is Steve reading a story from the Island Echo, headlined Visiting Restrictions at St. Mary's to Remain in Place to Keep Patients Safe. The Isle of Wight NHS Trust is reminding islanders that visiting restrictions remain in place for all NHS services, despite the national lockdown rules easing and both cases and deaths plummeting in recent weeks. In November 2020, when England entered a second lockdown, the difficult decision was made to suspend visiting to all NHS Trust sites, except in exceptional circumstances, to help stop the spread of coronavirus. In order to keep protecting patients, staff and the public, the Isle of Wight NHS Trust says it is necessary to keep the restricted visiting arrangements in place. To maintain safe social distancing and reduce the risk of infection, the Trust requests that patients attending any hospital appointment should arrive on time, not to arrive early, and to attend alone. If the patient needs to be accompanied, one carer is permitted in exceptional circumstances. Visitors will only be considered in exceptional circumstances where one visitor, an immediate family or carer, will be permitted to visit. These include one regular carer for a patient with additional needs, for example, with dementia or learning difficulties, one parent or guardian for a child, for a patient receiving end-of-life care, for a patient where a change in treatment would benefit from a meaningful exchange, one close relative for a long-stay patient where a visitor would improve well-being. You can contact the ward sister or the charge nurse to discuss if exceptional circumstances exist. St Mary's Hospital continues to welcome birth partners to be present for consultant appointments, all scans, labour, birth and postnatal visits. In line with government guidance, all visitors, birth partners and outpatients must not be experiencing any coronavirus symptoms and must wear a face mask unless exempt. Mary Aubrey, the chief nurse, said, "We understand how important attending an appointment with a loved one can be, or how visiting a family member or friend in hospital is, but we have to continue to protect our patients, staff and the wider community. It is great news for everybody that the national lockdown restrictions are easing and that we are slowly being able to see our family and friends outside, but we cannot be complacent and we need to continue to do everything possible to keep people safe and help contain the spread of COVID-19. Although we are keeping the restriction of visitors in place, we urge people in need of healthcare to continue to use our services. We are here for you. To help families and loved ones stay connected with patients while in hospital, each ward has a telephone system in place so patients can use an iPad or mobile phone to contact loved ones. The Trust has also been running a message to loved ones service and an essential items delivery service via the main reception."
Former High Sheriff Caroline Peel becomes Isle of Wight Deputy Lieutenant, Isle of Wight Radio. Mrs. Caroline Peel, who has just stepped down as High Sheriff, has been appointed as a Deputy Lieutenant of the Isle of Wight. In her role as High Sheriff from 2020 to 2021, she was very involved in supportive work during the pandemic. She built up the High Sheriff's Trust to enable it to focus on providing monetary support to the organisations that have been working with the more vulnerable and isolated members of the community. Quite apart from her outstanding work as High Sheriff during this last difficult year, Caroline has had a long history of work for the voluntary sector. She was born on the island and has maintained her family links here all her life while working in the charity sector as well as co-running a property management company in London. She's actively involved in the RNLI on the island, being president of the Bembridge Guild and vice chair of the RNLI Isle of Wight Board. She served as Commodore of Bembridge Sailing Club from 2010 to 2011, and she played an active support role with Ventnor Botanic Gardens. The Lord Lieutenant of the Isle of Wight, Mrs. Susie Sheldon, said, "I'm delighted to welcome Caroline Peel to the Lieutenancy team, where her in-depth knowledge of many sectors of the Isle of Wight community will be invaluable."
This is Brian reading an article from On the Wight. Praise for islanders for sticking to COVID rules as businesses reopen. Islanders have been praised for supporting local business by sticking to the guidelines during the first week of restrictions being eased. From last Monday, residents could visit more shops, use personal services like hairdressers, and have food and drink served to them outside. The Isle of Wight Council's regulatory services team, including the COVID support officers, have worked closely with local businesses throughout the pandemic. They've been impressed with how businesses and the public have adapted to the new changes. Rachel Briscoe, Business Regulation and Public Protection Team Manager, said, "A key part of our role is checking in with businesses and making sure they are operating COVID safely and within the guidelines. We support and answer any questions they may have. Getting prepared to reopen has been a massive challenge for local businesses that have been closed for months. We have seen major investments in time and money to enable them to welcome back people safely. The vast majority of islanders have been sensible and cautious when visiting establishments, but with the virus still very much in the community, we need people to carry on with this approach." Rachel added, "It's been tough for the local high street traders throughout the whole pandemic, and it is important to support local businesses now more than ever. When people shop locally, they're not just supporting their favourite store or market stall, but the whole island community. To celebrate the reopening of high streets, the council has produced a video to welcome back residents in a safe and inviting way. The short film highlights the efforts of two local businesses, the Lifeboat East Cows and Number 66 Cards and Gifts Ride, have made to make sure their premises are COVID secure and issues a rallying call for people to support their local shops and communities. Islanders are being encouraged to share the video as widely as possible to encourage people to be safe when they're visiting island businesses. Sue McLeod of Number 66 Cards and Gifts explained some of the measures they put in place to ensure the safety of their customers and staff. She said, "It's so exciting to be open again. As you come in, we ask you to put on your mask, to use the NHS COVID-19 app, and to sanitize your hands, all at the door. Once you get to the counter, there is a Perspex screen to keep you safe and the member of staff serving you. This summer, we're really looking forward to welcoming customers old and new into Number 66. The latest rate of new cases of COVID-19 on the Isle of Wight is 8.5 per 100,000 population, the third lowest in England. Simon Bryant, the Council's Director of Public Health, said our actions, no matter how small, would have a real impact on making sure this remained the case. He said, "Think COVID safe and continue with hands, face, space and ventilate. As hospitality venues begin to open up, everyone using them should provide their names and contact details. If you have a smartphone, it's easy to do this by downloading the NHS COVID-19 app and scanning the premises QR code. This is really important in halting the spread of the virus. Up-to-date information about testing and details of all the support on offer for residents and businesses is available at www.keeptheislandsafe.org.
This is Chris, reading an article from the Isle of Wight County Press. Seagrass plan for mermaid gin and Isle of Wight Wildlife Trust. The Hampshire and Isle of Wight Wildlife Trust is joining forces with the Isle of Wight Distillery, helping to make the two counties wilder. Home of the island's mermaid gin, the Isle of Wight Distillery, hopes the partnership will protect the Solent's internationally important seagrass meadows. The joint working is part of the Trust's Wilder Solent initiative. The UK has lost more than 90% of critical seagrass meadows in the last 100 years. The grass-like leaves provide a unique ecosystem for marine wildlife and capture carbon around 35 times faster than tropical rainforests. The meadows, which can be found on the Isle of Wight's coast, are nicknamed the lungs of the ocean. Xavier Baker, co-founder of the Isle of Wight Distillery, said, "Through our net zero initiative, we're already supporting seagrass meadows abroad, but wanted to also have impact locally. The Solent's very dear to us all at the distillery, so we're delighted to be part of the Wilder Solent initiative. Having gone plastic free 2 years ago and then achieving net zero, it's just another step in our journey to being an environmentally responsible business. As well as financially supporting the project, the team will take part in the Hampshire and Isle of Wight Wildlife Trust Marine Ambassador Training Scheme. Staff will have the opportunity to become Solent Marine Champions, supporting surveys and beach cleanups. Dr. Tim Ferrero, Senior Marine Biologist at Hampshire and Isle of Wight Wildlife Trust, said, "Enabling seagrass to restore to its historical levels needs a multifaceted approach. Our Solent Seagrass Restoration Project is one part of the puzzle, but equally as important is increasing awareness and support for this incredible marine species. This partnership will help inspire others and create a movement of businesses and individuals acting for seagrass, as well as other marine wildlife living in these waters. Together, we will create a wilder Solent."
This is Michael reading an article from the Isle of Wight Radio. Oil distribution permission sought by East Cowes firm despite 4 months of operating. Permission to continue using a site in East Cowes for oil distribution is being sought despite it already being in operation for over 4 months. Certus Energy has submitted the application for a temporary period of a year to continue using the former garage forecourt on York Avenue in East Cowes as a base as planning permission is sought, for a bigger fuel depot up the road in Whippingham. The energy company is looking to install three 125,000 litre tanks, an office building and a switch room close to Seacam at the nearby Technology Park to form a more permanent base. It took a bigger role in the island's fuel supply following the closure of Island Fuels, who were also in East Cowes. Since the closure, residents have only been able to get fuel from Certus, while the Whippingham application is determined. Certus have been using an area in York Avenue garage without planning permission. Now a retrospective application is asking to change the use of the York Avenue garage site after work was completed in December last year, installing an access gate and fence, and has operated there ever since. The Isle of Wight Council confirmed in January this year through its planning authority it was investigating the site after receiving an enforcement complaint. Planning documents submitted on behalf of CERTAS by Trident Engineering Consultants say the site would also house a small vehicle with a 12,000-litre wagon, which travels from the mainland to the island. They said the wagon would be parked at the site with a smaller vehicle distributing oil around the island, coming back to the York Avenue site to refill. Once the fuel distribution is completed on the island, the vehicles would return to the mainland. Documents have not specified whether the 12-month period the company is asking for will be from when the application could be approved or from the date the site was first used back in December. A representative for Island Roads, acting as Highways Authority, said that despite visiting the site, more information is needed. To view the proposals, 21/00552/4. You can view the Council's planning register.
This is Lisa, CEO of Site for White, welcoming you to this week's Talking News. This week has been busy in the preparation of the newsletter due out next week. Please remember, if you would like to put an article into the newsletter, offer any tips, or perhaps be our Spotlight member, never hesitate to contact us at the office on 52205. Each month we do a feature on one member and how their life has evolved with living with sight loss. These stories are always very well received, so if you would like to be our member of the month, please do not hesitate to contact us. Thank you. Also included in the newsletter this time is information about scams. IWASP, the Isle of Wight Against Scams Partnership, was formed back in 2016 and now has over 30 organisations associated with it, including Site for Wight. By using a collaboration of so many organisations, the idea is that when scams come to light, they can be quickly passed on to members. This will be included in the Alexa skill, which we have written and is due to go live early May. This week, we also welcome two new members of staff to Site for Wight. We have two new apprentices who have started this week, Martin and Liberty. Martin will maybe be working on the databases and Liberty will be posted on reception. So when we are able to reopen, I'm sure she will be very pleased to meet each and every person who comes through the door. So please, everybody, stay safe. Lockdown is easing, but the virus is still out there. So please stay safe. Thank you, Lisa.
Skip News, week commencing Monday, the 26th of April. Yarmouth area, On the Rocks, Bridge Road. Seaview area, Pear Tree Cottage, Circular Road. Newport area, 78 New Street. Shanklin area, 28 Hungerbury Close, 12 Clarence Gardens. Binstead area, outside 55 Jellicoe Road. Totland area, Island Cottage, York Road. Cowes area, 72 High Street. Ryde area, 7 Swanmore Road. Ventnor area, outside South Bank, Park Avenue. Scaffolding. Ryde area, 51 George Street, 1B Cross Street, 183 High Street, Ryde Bakery, 50 Union Street. Newport area, Guildhall High Street, 2-8 Carisbrook Road, Halifax High Street. Sandown area, Trouville Hotel, Sandown Esplanade, Flat C, St George's Hall, Barnaby's Restaurant, Pier Street. Cowes area, 31 Mill Hill Road, 72 High Street, Toby's of Cowes, 9 High Street, 39 Cross Street, 5 Birmingham Road. Yarmouth area, Grove Cottage, St James's Street. Shanklin area, 77 Regent Street. Ventnor area, Miramere, Hanbury Road. Blythe Cottage, Blythe Shoot, Chail.
Sight for White would like to thank you for listening to this week's edition of the Talking News. We would also like to thank our volunteers for reading, and a particular thank you to the Isle of Wight County Press, On the Wight, Island Echo, Isle of Wight Radio, and a special thank you to Vectis Radio.